managing director of the global education innovation. She's the chair of the corporate management, the AEC. Of course, I can't stress enough on the presentation is not only because of activities and these things, but also to be the good readers and the speakers have a lot to tell you.
Good afternoon. How are you, everyone? My name is Alia Basuni. Okay, I'm the chair of the Department of Management and a professor of finance at Finance. Okay? I see a lot of my students. Okay, first of all, I'm excited about this competition, and you should be excited as well. I think you should look at it, Mish, as a competition. You have to look at this that Nana, I'm actually going to play it. Because the boss said to tell you play with grading that we are. Unfortunately, we at AUC, we sometimes teach you things in class and we practice without the idea. We have to practice what we preach. So, when you know, Kalim and I was just in a training, Kalim and I graduations, investing, if you don't ever invest, and you never know what is a stock market, how do you trade a stock, what do you do. But this is an excellent chance for you to start doing that with virtual money, from a fish pressure, until you find that and now I'm actually comfortable, and you start using your own money, and then there is a very high probability you're going to lose, but there's also a very high probability that you're going to gain, that you have to know how to do it. Yeah. And I love trading. I personally trade all around the world. Someone who really believes in stock markets and trading, and I do different strategies, which I'm going to talk to you about in a little bit. But at the end of the day, it's a very exciting place. It's a place where a lot of things can go wrong. But it's nice to have a stock market trading competition here, because what you're going to do is see a glimpse, to wish monkey for 4 weeks. You will see making money or losing. We have actually very bad markets happening now globally. We don't know whether you're going to make money or lose money, but at least the most important thing for you is that you have a strategy. One of the messages I want to tell you. You are now going to do a stock market trading competition. Look at it as a game, and you need to set the rules for your game. So, then you need to say, now I'm a push, and I want to beat others trading in the stock market. How am I going to do that? So you need to have a strategy. Your strategy is and so on. So you need to have a strategy. Number one rule from experience. When I personally deviated from my trading strategy, it looks very interesting, and now it doesn't follow my strategy, so I'm going to trade, I lose. Okay? So you have to have a strategy, you have to be very disciplined. It doesn't mean in the strategy, I go in, and then I see what happens with my strategy, and based on my learnings, I update my strategy. You have to have a strategy. You can't just go in and say, I'm going to buy, I'm going to sell. Have a strategy, be disciplined, okay? And at the end of the day, you need to have this strategy because you need to use this as a learning. صح? أنا دخلة وI want to trade. If I don't have a strategy, هل حارف what works and what doesn't? But I think it's very important for all of you to know in the aggregate, we have the winning team. The whole winning team عمل إيه؟ They will share their experience and they need to tell you what did they do to make money. And actually, I love it when we have a losing team and they share what they did, because we need to know what did they do and what went wrong and what went bad. Okay. Trading is something that you have to be disciplined in, you have to have a strategy, but you also have to have a lot of knowledge. And that's why we have this competition. We have very knowledgeable people from Mubasher that are going to help you, because there is a science to trading that you need to know about, because then there's a lot of art. So, my second message before we introduce our speakers is financial markets, there is no such thing as a free lunch. I will stand here and tell you there is no such thing as a free lunch. We can make a lot of money and we can beat others if we do a strategy, that actually makes use of an inefficiency. I spotted it and I made a strategy to make use of it and I made money out of it. One of it, these things is arbitrage, which I'm a very big expert on. I have many, many papers on arbitrage. Arbitrage, is a way to make use of, it's a strategy to make use of inefficiencies in the market. مشكلة strategies cannot last forever. Because when people see عليها trading, and you see that she's making money, you're going to start looking at what is she doing, صح? And then all of us are going to say, there's a strategy, we can work with this strategy, if everyone starts doing it, فخلاص الفلوس بتتقسم علينا كلنا, and the strategy doesn't beat the market anymore. But you have to know that even if you can beat others and beat the market, it is not something that you can do over 15, 20 years. And with that, the example is shared given that I went to classes of finance, Black and Scholes, yeah? The Abdul can handle a huge fund, huge hedge fund actually, it's called the Long Term Capital Management. So we have phenomenal returns. They have another prize, by the way, for a financial model, Black and Scholes. And they went there. Okay? Why? Because they thought their strategy will make them beat the market forever. And they went to a certain point where the strategy, they cannot beat the market forever. عشان كده انا بقول strategy, you have to have a strategy. So you have to be very careful to update your strategy, but say, never go in and say, I will beat everyone else and I will make this free lunch. لو في حد جاي يقول لكم كده ادوني فلوسكو, انا دي بقى بقولها from an educational point of view. اي حد يجي يقول لك هات فلوسك, I guarantee 100% في الريتيرن over the next 5 years, there's something wrong there. صح? I can go on my Twitter account and I always tweet all of these bad examples of people who promised things and then they took everyone's money and it was a hoax. صح? But no, you cannot promise abnormal returns over extended periods of time. صح? But we can make money over the short, medium, and long term by making sure that you understand what's happening in the market. But these are just very quick messages on trading. But what's most important is know the signs, know what happens when we trade. Understand that you need to have a strategy. Test your strategy, see if it works or not. Update your strategy, and then take this as a game. For you to try out, يعني investing and how can I make money and what works and what doesn't work and so on. Okay? That's just my intro speech يعني for trading, my own يعني experience from trading in general. Yeah. The next thing is that I really want to welcome our colleagues from Mubasher, okay, who are giving us the time, the platform, and giving you all of their experience to show you how to trade. I'm very, very grateful to every single one of you. And today you're going to have them throughout for the next couple of weeks in sessions, workshops, showing you how to trade, all of this. Because today, Kamen, we're going to have today we're going to give you a speech, Mr. Amr Elalfy, who is here with us today. He's going to talk to you a little bit more about trading, and I'm going to say his bio a little bit. He's the managing director and global head of research at the Mubasher Financial Services, and he has over 17 years of experience in investing and trading. He actually is also a professor. He's an adjunct faculty, and he teaches in our Master of Science in Finance on portfolio management and trading. Before he was with Mubasher, he was the director and co-head of research at CI Capital, as well as that before that he was an analyst at King Street Capital Management in New York. He has his bachelor degree in finance and investment from Barrett College, which is in the City University of New York. He has an MBA from AUC, and he is also a CFA chartered holder and is very heavily involved in the CFA society here in Egypt. Thank you very much, Amr, for giving the time and helping all of our students. Thank you very, very much. Okay? We're also joined by Mr. Mohamed Al-Bihedi, who is a business analyst manager at Mubasher for Securities. He joined Mubasher in 2008, and he has 9 years of experience in the stock market field. He's a certified broker here in Egypt, and also he is a certified short seller from the clearing house. Since 2012, he started to hold various sessions in stock trading in many universities in Egypt, and he graduated from the Faculty of Commerce in 2006, so thank you very much for being with us. And finally, last but not least, we have Mohamed Musa, who is also a market specialist equity, and I am at Thomson Reuters Corporation. Prior to this, he served as a senior institutional sales trader at MBK Capital. He has his MBA degree in banking and risk management in 2000, and he will finish it in 2006. And he has over 10 years of experience in equity, so thank you very much. Okay? So we'd like to welcome all of our speakers from Mubasher, from Reuters. I want to wish you all the best of luck. Okay? Please try to enjoy it and learn from it. Awesome. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for the time and joining this competition. It's my pleasure to be back at the AUC talking about fundamental illness. It's something that I really love and pray for. As Dr. Alia mentioned, my background mostly is in financial analysis, fundamental analysis, so to speak. And it's my pleasure today to just give you a glimpse about fundamental analysis and what we do as financial analysts day in, day out, and try to pick the stories that would make sense to invest in the long term. I understand that the competition is not that long in terms of duration, but I think we can take it as experience and as an experience for us to learn how to use fundamental analysis along with other techniques like technical analysis and the trading studies, different trading studies, and how we can sail across the financial markets. I would like to thank the AUC for giving me the opportunity to speak to you today about this. And already Dr. Ali gave a brief background about myself, so I'm not going to dwell too much about it. But I want to just mention the couple of institutions I worked for. When I started working, I worked at King Street Capital Management. And actually, Dr. Ali, I just spoiled one of the slides that I have about long-term capital management, because it is, I was at the States at the time when this happened. Just the hedge fund just blew up. It's a different hedge fund. My hedge fund, alhamdulillah, was still ongoing and it's grown its capital by 50 times since I left. I'm not sure if this is good or bad. I mean, it could be expanded after I left. King Street Capital Management, basically their hedge fund, specialize in distressed securities and equities, and they also buy bank debts. And their strategy was a very long term. They don't really care much about the day-to-day volatility. They try to find undervalued investment opportunities, and they get in, and they have the patience to stay along the course until they realize the value that they have in mind. And I think this is the value, this is what we call value investing. If you read about Warren Buffett, I think this is the school that they come from. Long-term capital management, I don't have a slide on that, but it happened around the time I was there. I was there between 1997 to 1999. I think the crisis happened in 1998. So it tells you that even if you're a scientist or you have, like, and you're a Nobel laureate, you still can make mistakes. So I would compare with Dr. Aya that there's no free lunch, but there are sometimes, every now and then, could be some free lunches. Okay, the next company I worked for is Prime Securities back in Egypt when I came back. Since I came back to Egypt, my whole career has been in equity research, analyzing companies, setting target prices, putting recommendations. And this is, I think, one of the different lines of business that I love about fundamental analysis or the investment profession in general. Because it gives you a chance to speak out to your mind and give opinions and support this with evidence. I worked at CIBC, Vodafone. Vodafone has nothing to do with, obviously, with the financial analysis. But again, it tells you that even if you're a fundamental analyst or a financial analyst, you can still work elsewhere as opposed to being a technical analyst. I'm not going to be too harsh about technical analysis because I myself look at charts before I buy a stock because it's very informative. However, the way I think about fundamental analysis and technical analysis, I can actually give you a picture that fundamental analysis of being a financial analyst is almost like being a lawyer. You want to win your case before the judge or the jury, and to get that, you have to have the evidence. Can I just say that I believe that the defendant is innocent, and that's it. And look at his looks, he looks innocent, just give me the verdict. You have to dig deeper, look at the case, try to find the evidence, and support your recommendation with that evidence. On the other side, if you think about the technical analyst, now that I think about it, my way to the event today, I was thinking, which profession would I compare the technical analyst to? I came up to mind maybe the weatherman. The weatherman looks at maps and tells you there are some clouds there. It could be hot tomorrow, it could be rainy tomorrow, but sometimes it doesn't really work. So it tells you that tomorrow is going to be cold, it turns out to be very hot. And today we're in March and we're wearing short sleeves. So technical analysts, they use also charts, drawings, but charts of stocks. And I told you that I look at them myself, but they're not always right. So either it's not, is it a science? Could you think of fundamental analysis as a science, because we deal with numbers. Or on the other hand, you can think of technical analysis as an art. You look at drawings, and it's pretty easy to communicate. However, I'd like to take the quote, Dr. Aswad Gamudran, he's a professor, finance professor at New York University, and he thinks that, no, it's not science or art, and I believe the same way, it is a craft. So actually, you can learn. If it's a science or an art, I mean, basically you can just, and it's not perfect science. 1 + 1 is not equal 1, it's equal 2. Sometimes in finance, it's equal 3. When you have, for example, mergers and acquisitions, two companies together can be worth more than the two companies separately. And technical analysis is not really an art, because at the end of the day, even if you have madness, there should be some method to the madness. So you have to think about it and what's driving the market behavior. Could be just psychology, could be events, expectations, fear, greed, and you just need to stay the course and be disciplined and be patient as well. Okay, my students in finance class know these movies. If you haven't seen these movies, I think you need to look them up and try to watch them, because they're very informative. They give you an idea what the Wall Street does, starting from the old days, the trading places, by Eddie Murphy. Actually, they moved one homeless guy to be a manager of the trading floor of one of the big Wall Street firms. Obviously, it's a fiction. But it gives you an idea that you can actually turn someone who doesn't know anything into an expert. And the other way around, the guy who was managing the trading floor became a homeless guy. It's a funny movie, it's nice to take a look at. Obviously, you probably know Wall Street, the two sequels. They're a few years apart. But the first one, I like the first one better because it gives you an insight of what goes on behind closed doors on the corporate environment. Basically, when someone wants to take over a company, and the markets are all full of these stories. And this is when you make very big money, because there's an acquisition, or an imminent acquisition, and you try to get into that spot before everyone knows about this acquisition, and the stock shoots higher. The Inside Job is mostly a documentary talking about the financial crisis, and with some interviews with finance professors who actually haven't been or not really that ethical, publishing white papers about, for example, the Iceland banking system, saying that it's very sound, there should be no problem. And a few months later, the banking system just collapsed. They said that they would pay or bribe some money to just write these articles. So you can still read things that have to make sense out of what you read. Does it make sense or not? Next. Movie, Mubasher. It's takes place on the eve of the financial crisis, when they tried to broker a deal for one of the defunct investment banks. We had two at the time, Bears Stearns, and later on Lehman Brothers. Too big to fail, also. It's almost like a documentary, but it's in a fiction way. So I think it also gives you an idea of what goes on between the central banks, the government, and the investment bankers. Because even though the financial crisis has been tremendous and actually spilled over into Europe and the rest of the world, I don't think anyone got went to jail for this. So it's very strange. Some other movies that can relate to other stocks, these are almost in real life, talking about Jobs, Apple, how the Apple story transformed from being a small company, then almost going bankrupt, then becoming one of the largest. One point in time, it was the largest company in terms of market cap in the world. Second movie, it's about Facebook, the social network, and it gives you an insight also what dirty stuff goes on behind the doors. And you try to take over the company, and you play around with the venture capitalists to take over that company, and almost like you bake a cake and you eat it all for yourself. One before last was The Wolf of Wall Street. It also gives you an idea of how psychology plays an important role in finance. Sometimes you see a stock that's going up so much, I don't understand why it's going up. The company is losing money, left, right, and center. The company keeps raising capital, they still lose money, and investors are just not. You know, the stock keeps going up. Because there's psychology part that goes into it. You have to think, are you want to play this game, take the risk, and play the psychology game, and maybe you get hurt or burned. Or you want to stay the course again and just be disciplined and look for long-term investment opportunities that you believe in the business model, as opposed to just picking stocks out of the pink sheets, very, very small stocks that may not actually fly. The last movie that I just saw recently is The Big Short, and it gives you a story also between about some of the hedge fund managers who actually made money out of the financial crisis, and Christian Bale is the one that actually made money, and I saw it in my flight back from Dubai just a couple of days ago, and actually the guy's basically is the fundamental analyst, because everyone at the time of the financial crisis, everyone was selling mortgage loans, and these mortgage loans had adjustable rates, meaning that after a few years, the interest rates would go higher, and people who did not have the financial capability, they were buying houses, like four or five houses, using mortgages that were very cheap at the time, and they were not really concerned about what's going to happen in the future, because if something happens and I cannot pay my mortgage payments, I can still sell one of these houses in the market, and because the housing market was going higher every day in terms of prices. But when these loans started to default and the delinquencies started rising, Christian Bale actually picked up something that he was expecting that this would happen eventually, and his expectation was in the second quarter of 2007, almost a year before the financial crisis hit. And this is what his investment rationale was. And to benefit out of that, he was shorting mortgage-backed security, or actually taking a short position using credit default swaps. And his fund is actually started losing because the delinquencies have been increasing in the mortgages that actually support the mortgage-backed securities have actually been going down the value. The mortgage-backed securities themselves have actually stayed the course and they did not lose value. So this was very strange for him because when it happened, his fund was down like 20%, and investors started thinking of pulling money out of his fund. And this is almost like a bank run when an investment manager does badly. Investors just start pulling out the money, and he gave them like an ultimatum: said that no one's going to pull out his money until next few months. And later on, actually, he made the deck and the crisis hit, and eventually, this is what I'm talking about, the patience. He was patient enough for the market to correct. And when the market corrected, his fund was up over 400%. So it's a very nice story, and it is also about the greed in financial services industry, specifically investment banking. So before I start, we have 2 hours today, so I'll just give you a glimpse also about fundamental assets. And what we actually do. Fundamental analysis is basically looking at stocks, trying to come up with a value using some numbers, financial statements, and stories. Stories meaning that what the company does, what the management team is like, are they strong enough, do they have a track record, how is the sector that you're working in performing, how is the market itself, or the global markets affecting my company, or the one that I'm studying. So basically, you can look at it from top down or bottom up. Top down, basically, you search, if you're a global investor, you just search for the best market around there. Maybe you could use some macroeconomic indicators, global GDP growth rates, inflation rates, exchange rates, are they stable enough or not? Then you start selecting which markets you're gonna be investing in. Then you go into the sector level, and you start selecting the best sectors that will benefit. If you like one market, not all sectors will be performing that well, but you want to limit your selection to the best performing or the sectors that you think will perform the best. Then you start selecting stocks out of those sectors. And you use ratios and financial statements and also valuation to come up with the best investment strategy for you. This is top down, but you can also look at stocks from bottom up. I think for the purpose of this competition, you don't need to do the top down much. You already in the Egyptian markets, so you just need to look for sectors need to look where, which sector, which stocks in these sectors will perform the best in the future. Bottom up, basically running a huge database of numbers, whether you're looking at multiples, growth rates, profitability ratios, and try to come up with a short list to start focusing on certain stocks. Then you work your way up and try to find the story behind these numbers. So for example, sometimes you look for the cheapest stocks in terms of multiples, price to earnings ratio, the price divided by earnings of the company. The cheapest, or the lower the price to earnings ratio, the cheapest, the cheaper the company is. But they're not usually the cheapest companies. There could be some reason for that. Just to give you an example, for example, if you look at the S&P 500 in the States, the price to earnings ratio for the S&P 500 ranges between 15 times to sometimes 20 times. But in Egypt, for example, if you look at that same ratio, now it's trading between 6 to 7 times, and the highest it could be 12 times. So it's a very divergence between Egyptian market and the US markets. But there could be reason for that. Even though absolute terms, you see that the Egyptian market is very cheap compared to the US market, but the Egyptian market may not reach that 20 times as a whole. Why is that? Because there's other factors in play. For example, the US market is a developed market, and usually developed markets, they get high premium. High premium is those multiples. And Egypt as an emerging market, they get this discount for that. So they will not be trading at 20 times earnings like the States. Also other markets like Vietnam, which is a frontier market, even less developed market, do trade at very similar, low single digits multiples. So if you look at stocks, you could have a P ratio for a stock that's trading at 6 times, and another stock that's trading at 12 times. But the 12 times stock could actually be worth, or it could be a very good investment opportunity as opposed to the 6 times. Because you think about how earnings will grow at this company. Maybe the company itself is trading at 6 times, it's very slow. The business model is not that great. The competition is eating the market share, and the growth in earnings is not that high. But if you look at the 12 times company, could actually be growing its revenues and income by maybe 20-30% per year. So I would make better investments. It makes more sense to me to buy the 12 times price earnings ratio as opposed to 6 times. So it's not just what you see at face value. Do not take it just for granted. You just have to dig deeper and read about the companies and try to estimate what goes on or what's going to happen in the future. And you can either do this yourself or with the help of others, like reading research reports. And I understand that also for the purpose of this competition, you probably have access to research reports done by fundamental analysts or equity analysts who actually take the time to research a company and come up with evaluation and forecasts. And they meet management teams and they try to put their opinion in this 10 to 15 page report. So reading this also, you need to read them also with a pinch of salt. You don't take it for granted. There could be some conflict of interest of these research analysts publishing reports because they work at the end of the day in one of the big firms or maybe another player in the market. There could be some hidden agendas for why they're putting a buy recommendation on this stock. So you need to read behind or between the lines. And we've had our share of ethical issues in the States, where we actually, the CFA program, the first thing we learn is ethics, code of ethics. But all the issues of the big major problems actually happen in the States, and they still continue to happen. Long-term capital management, it was not an ethical issue, it was just betting too much on one side of the trade and forgetting thinking that the world would go a certain way, and it's not always the case. But there are some other ethical problems, like one of the famous investors actually, Madoff actually been delivering in 20% per year every year for the past few years, and everyone was putting money on him, but there's one CFA charter holder who was actually trying to mimic his performance, looking at his investment strategy, said, okay, this is what his investment strategy is, let me try to replicate that. See, really, if I had invested the same way that he did, would have made would have made the money, the same money that he made, and it turns out now there's something fishy about it, because they couldn't replicate his performance. And later on, actually, the guy was jailed, and turns out that it was only a Ponzi scheme. We had our fair share also here in Egypt. Some companies also keep promising you 6-7% per month, and we're not sure exactly how they made this money. So you have to be careful because, so like I said, there's no free lunch, but you have to be careful with the investment strategy. Just read the investment strategy of what those investors do and try to make sense out of it. So as a fundamental analyst, I go through the macro stuff. I don't have to be an economist, but I can look for the most important facts that I need to consider in my analysis. For example, if I'm covering or evaluating a steel company, I need to look at the macroeconomic picture. What's the real GDP growth rate like? How about construction? Is it a big percentage of GDP? Is it going to be driving the economy in the future? This is basically my market, or the market driver for me as a sector, as a steel sector. I can also look for foreign currency, because in fluctuation foreign currency, if I'm importing iron ore, this would negatively affect my cost if the Egyptian pound devalues. So this is another macro issue. If I'm a heavily indebted company, so I need to consider the direction of interest rates. Is it going to be higher or lower? If I'm a highly leveraged company, I'd be concerned if interest rates would be going higher. So this means more cost to me and lower profitability. Now I go to the sector level, and I need to look at my company, where does it stand? If you've already seen this before in one of your classes, we talk about the Porter's model, the different factors that affect industry competition, starting from, does your product have a substitute? What's the competition like? What's the bargaining power of buyers and sellers? Okay. And the regulatory environment, all these factors affect your sector. And also you have the demand and supply side. Are you on the demand side or are you on the supply side? Is it a supply gap or a demand gap? How is your company going to benefit out of that? And how are the prices going to be determined? Because sometimes the prices are determined by the government, and there are some ceilings for certain prices. So you have to look into how the products or the services prices are being set. Also, you have if you talk about cement company, you have to look for the barriers of entry. So sometimes companies have to get a license before they start operations. For example, in Egypt, you have to get a license to have a cement company. So is this a high barrier to entry or is it a low barrier to entry? This also determines how competitive my environment is or the industry is. After I go through all of this, I go now to the bottom, which is the financial performance of the company. And you look at the financial statements historically. Usually as a financial analyst, we spread all these financial statements into Excel. You have to be very good with Excel. And you don't spread them the way that the financial, the companies present their financial statements, because you have to have your own financial model, and you have to have some standardization. Because companies report their financial results differently. Some companies show you the EBITDA, some companies don't even show you the EBITDA number. Sometimes companies have the depreciation excluded, some companies have the depreciation included in cost of goods sold and SG&A. So you have to standardize all this so you can be able to compare companies to one another. Then you look at ratios, you look at the valuation, and you try to understand what happened in the history or historically, then try to project what goes on in the future. And this is one thing I think we as financial analysts spend most of the time on, and it's not right, which is basically everyone looks at the future. Everyone wants to be a forecaster. Everyone wants to be a weatherman. But it's not always right, because you need to first, before you forecast, you have to really digest what happened in the past and try to analyze. Because at the end of the day, we're a financial analyst. You have to analyze, you're not a financial forecaster, you're a financial analyst. You have to analyze history as much as you can. And if you look at a cyclical company like steel, cement, cyclical companies that are affected by the business cycle in the economy, you have to look not just 3 or 4 years back, you have to look at probably 10 years back. so you can capture the full business cycle. So you do not base your forecast on the last few years, which could actually maybe the worst or the best years for this company. You have to adjust for seasonality or cyclicality. So we need to focus on analysis, then we start forecasting. And to do forecasting, you have to know exactly what happened in the past, because you're not just putting growth rates, you have to digest the numbers, you have to break out the numbers. Revenues, where does revenue come from? If they're producing a product, so it's volume times price. If there's a service, you need to know exactly how they price their service, what's the capacity that they have, and you start forecasting. And for the cost, try to break down the cost as much as possible. Then you don't have to know exactly all the different parts of the cost, because companies do not usually give you all this for competitive reasons. They don't want the competitors to know exactly what the cost structure is. But overall, even if you don't know anything about the company, you can still know if it's a steel company, what's the biggest cost that they, what's the biggest cost component that they have, and this is what I can actually use to project my cost. There are some factors in the companies that you don't really find in the financial statements, which is like management experience, what's the background, what's the credibility of the management team. If there's any change in management teams, this might affect your forecasts, because what happened in the past is not usually gonna be repeated in the future. This is what asset managers always tell you in fine print. Your stock performance does not guarantee future performance. And sometimes, even after they set historical numbers, maybe there are no clues for you to make forecasts in the future. For example, the company itself might have changed its business model altogether. We've seen this with Roscom Construction Industries. It used to be a cement and building and base business. They sold the cement business and now they're in the fertilizers business. Recently, Roscom Telecom Media used to be a telecom business. Now they're into financial services, solar energy. So even historical statements now, you just need to look at and see what the management team has actually been doing recently, because they are the same management team going forward. But I'm not going to be able to use these numbers to forecast the future. So I have to look for other comparables. Now I need to do some mix and match between the different industries to come up with the new company that I'm actually looking at. But fundamental analysis has some history, and it started recently, 1930s. But actually, this was because of a few market frenzies that we've seen in the past. This one of the frenzies that we had was in 1636-37, when we had the tulip mania. Everyone was buying this flower after it contracted the disease or the virus, and actually changed the way the flower looks, and it's become a collectible item. Everyone was buying this tulip, and the price of the tulip flower is actually rising quite high. Then eventually, at sometime in the future, people started realizing, why are we paying this much for this tulip? It's just a flower. And started relaxing, and people lost their homes just buying these flowers. There's another story also, the South Sea Company in England, and actually Isaac Newton was an investor in this company, and he lost 20,000 sterling back in 1720. This company was given a monopoly of the trade between the trade that happens with Latin America. And at the time there was some war with Spanish and British, and this company was getting this monopoly, so everyone had high hopes about this company and how it's gonna perform in the future. If you have a monopoly of trade, maybe you can misuse or exploit this monopoly as you can. But actually, the monopoly was not really materialized, and there still was some wars in Latin America, and the company did not really manage to benefit out of this monopoly. So let me say this, then see here the stock price been rising quite high, then it crashed again when nothing materialized and everyone realized that they're just buying from the sea, not the company itself. And in our part of the world, we had an issue also, one of our frenzies in Kuwait, Suez Manet. It's a parallel market that actually used backdated checks for people who buy stocks. They just, instead of paying cash, they just wrote checks to one another until one day in the future. One of those backdated checks bounced, so there was no balance in in the check or the bank account, and started the downward spiral. And everyone was saying left, right, and center, and the market crashed. These are all have something in common, which is basically psychology. You're buying two because you think it's going to go higher. You're buying this stocks in the South Sea company because you think it's going to do well. You're investing in money because you don't have to pay anything right now, just write a check, and you almost guaranteed that the stock that you buy, you can be selling it in the future at a higher price. They're all premise, you know, they have the premise that things will be better than before. And here's the long-term capital management story. And actually, it is the two partners, the two guys who actually won the Nobel Prize for economics, finding out how to calculate the valuation of options. And then we were partners in this company, long-term capital management. It's a hedge fund company. And you can see here the performance of long-term capital management since 1994 up to leading to the 1998 before they collapsed. This is the performance. 1,000 had turned into 4,000. If you had invested in Dow Jones Industrial Average, the red, you've made only, you could still double your money, but at long-term capital management, you've actually quadrupled your money. And this is the US Treasury, this is the safest investment. As you can see here, the collapse here happened, but the collapse did not really transform into a global crisis or a financial crisis in the States, because it was contained by the government, as opposed to the global financial crisis, which it affected many institutions. So here, there was some concerted effort orchestrated by the Federal Reserve to avoid any collapse of this long-term capital management. Still, the partners would lose the money. But if you have highly leveraged bets, you take on debt to bet in a certain way, and this certain way does not really materialize, all you need to do now to cut your losses is sell. Just sell your positions, or get out of your positions, so you can just recoup your equity or reduce your leverage. So for the long-term capital management to do that, they would be forced to sell. And having a forced seller in the market, what does this do to the price? It makes the price bond, and this is what the US government or the Federal Reserve did not want to do. And they had an agreement with different investment banks dealing with long-term capital management, and they, slowly they started buying these assets as a bailout plan. But this was a kind of just an angle or alarm for the US, but still, after that, 10 years later, exactly 10 years later, we had the financial crisis. Because psychology is still there. Psychology has been there in 1600, and now still 2016, we have same psychology affecting our markets. So who wins in these markets? Basically, the second person who has a kind of methodology that he adheres to. Sometimes psychology plays a very important part in investing, but you have to again realize why you're buying and why you're selling, and this is how you can make money. And also you need to have some risk management, because to me, I think it's not just about picking the right investments at the right time, it's also about picking the right time to sell, and to just raise the white flag that I've made a mistake and I'm out. So cutting your losses short can actually make you money. So even if you lose 10%, you can still save yourself another 20-30% of losses that you would have made if you had stayed in that position. So financial assets and fundamental assets started really basically from another crisis, which was back in 1929, the Great Depression. Everyone was thinking about, so why did we have this Great Depression with the market crash in 1929 and in the later years? Let's think about what we need to do to find out what could we have done to have predicted this crisis. So let's say we need to look at what we're buying. So we had two guys, two professors, Benjamin Graham and David Dodd. They actually came together and they published a book called Security Analysis. And this book, this is almost like the Bible for fundamental analysis. And they were teaching in Colombia. And they wanted to just explain to investors what they should do to pick stocks. So basically, if you want to buy a stock, why are you buying the stock? Are you just buying it because you expect it to go higher? Definitely, if you buy it, you expect it to go higher. But why is it going to be go higher? You have to have some method to evaluate this stock. And this method, in plain words, looking at cash flows of the of this stock that you're analyzing, it's all at the end of the day, it's about cash. It's the same thing we say that cash is king. So if you're not generating cash now, maybe you'll be generating cash in the future. So it's not necessarily the case that a negative or companies that generate negative cash flow today is not necessarily worth less. It could be worth more if we start generating positive cash flows in the future. So you need to forecast what's going to happen in the future and to try to come up with the cash flows that will come out of this company. So for me as a stockholder, I would look for dividends to be paid out as cash flows coming from the stock. But again, the dividends may not be paid out very soon. It could take maybe 5-10 years until the company starts paying out their first dividends. But eventually, at some time in the future, you'll pay out dividends, because otherwise no one would be buying the stock. So there's an expectation that even if the company does not pay dividends now, they eventually will pay dividends later. And we've seen this with some companies, for example, Microsoft. When it was starting out, there was no dividends. Recently, they've been paying dividends. Eventually, like Facebook, maybe they're not paying dividends, but later on, they have to pay dividends. At the end of the day, the cash flows have to come back to investors. And in the States, mostly, the cash flows can be given back to investors in two ways. Either you pay the investors cash dividends, and this is something investors don't really like in the States, because they have to pay taxes on that. And the other way of giving back cash to investors is by buying back shares. So usually, U.S. stocks have a share buyback program, saying that this year we're going to be buying back $20 billion worth of stock. And you just, if you're an investor who wants to sell, just give back a share to the company, and you can get your cash back. So it's all about cash flows, as I'm trying to say. I have to compare to gentleman here, Bill Gates, the founder of Microsoft, and Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett, at one point of time, was the richest man in the world. Now he's number three. Bill Gates is number one. And they're actually two friends. They have few common things together. And actually, Warren Buffett is a fundamental analyst. He has the patience. He started this company long time ago, and what he does is he looks for undervalued investments, and he invests in them for a long haul. As you can see here, fundamental analysis is like number three, but you don't really see technical analysis making it to the list here. And Warren Buffett, what did Warren Buffett do? He actually learned from Benjamin Graham. He studied with him at Columbia University. He was the only one, he got an A in his class. And Warren Buffett did, he started on his own. He had no money to start with, but he started picking cheap stocks. Then he bought this textiles company, Berkshire Hathaway, and in 1965, and used it as, not as a textiles company, but as an investment platform, an investment vehicle for him to start buying other stocks. So it's actually like his holding company. And the company is traded in the market. And one share, he has two different classes of shares, but one of the shares actually goes for $200,000, just one share. And he has ownership in Coca-Cola, Wells Fargo Bank, and different other insurance businesses. And they call him the broker of Manhattan. And when he lives in Nebraska, he didn't change his house, the same thing. And he didn't change his life, changed his lifestyle. And one of his saying that his kids, when he gave up some of his wealth actually for philanthropic activities, and when they asked him, why didn't you leave this for your kids, he said, I wanted them leave something for them to work on, not something for them not to do anything. So if you give them so much money, they're not going to do anything. But if you give them just enough, they will do something with what they have left. So it's all about fair value, looking for this holy grail. What's the right price for this security, whether you talk about stocks or bonds? Fair value, there's no one fair value for everything. Everyone has a different fair value, and that's why we have markets. If everyone thinks that this PC is worth $1,000 or £1,000, no one else will buy it at less or higher. It's worth $1,000. But fair value changes from one person to another depending on the risk perception, depending on their forecasts, depending on their expectations, depending on their growth expectations for the company. And this is what makes the market. So basically, fair value definition is a rational and unbiased estimate for the potential market price for good. You want to estimate what the potential price is for this good or service. And we're talking about investment, the good here will be our stock. We take into account different factors, and these factors you take into account, you make your forecast. You expect the revenues to grow at a certain rate, you expect the cost to be higher or lower, what's the margin of profitability that will eventually generate. And you take this into account and try to come up with the expected cash flows in the future, but this is all in the future. Now we want to value this stream of cash flows in the future now. So you discount everything to today's terms, which is basically taking the present value of the future cash flows. And then you need to compare the fair value to the market price. Because if the fair value is higher than the market price, you need to buy. If the fair value is lower than the market price, you either don't buy or you sell, you short sell. But in Egypt, they don't have short selling yet, which is basically borrowing shares from someone else, selling them in the market, and with the hope that the price of the stock will go lower, then you buy back the shares and return the shares that you borrowed in the first place. So short selling is not an option here in Egypt, so you have only one action to make money in this market, to buy and sell, not to sell and buy as well, just buy and sell. So you need to buy low and sell high. This is rule of thumb for you to make money. So you need to compare the market price to the fair value. And usually the fair value and the stock price or the market price are not, they rarely match. So if you look, for example, if you look at the Bloomberg Terminal and try to look at what everyone in the market, mainly fundamental analysts or equity analysts, what they expect of certain stock that they cover, and you try to plot, there's a function of the Bloomberg that you plot the analyst recommendation or analyst ratings versus the market price. And most of the time, you'll find that there's always a gap between the fair value and the market price. Usually, fair value is higher than the market price. The gap could be actually narrowed at some point. Sometimes they match together, but most of the time, the gap will remain. Why is that? A couple of reasons. One of the reasons is that financial analysts usually cover stocks that they believe are undervalued. If they think that the stock is overvalued and it's always going to be overvalued, you're not going to be really covering it much if you want to, because otherwise you're basically giving a recommendation of selling. And there's no harm of having a sell recommendation if you have short selling. You can still make money as a brokerage firm. But if you keep saying sell, 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 the management team of this company, they're not going to be forever talking to you. So you don't have management access. Because if you keep saying sell, 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 so they're not going to. So usually, if you look at the breakdown of recommendations of any research house, you find maybe like 60-70% of them are buys, and the hold is around 30%, and maybe 5% or so are sell. So you don't have so many sells. So usually, you look at the stock, you think it's undervalued, you have a higher fair value than the market price, and the gap continues to be there. This is one of the reasons that there's always a gap. Another reason is, I would say it's psychology, again, it's anchoring. When you anchor your expectations about, if you look at the stock, and let's say you think the stock is undervalued, and you've done your homework, and the fair value for the stock is £12, and the market price is 10. So you think there's a 20% upside. And later on something happens in the company, or maybe the market itself, everyone gets positive sentiment on the market, and now the stock instead of trading at 10, it's trading at 13. So if nothing has really changed except psychology and market sentiment, your recommendation now should be sell. Because you valued at 12, now the market is at 13. You should be saying it's 7, so it's overvalued now. But what happens is, usually, psychology kicks in as well. Say, okay, maybe my market knows something that I don't know about. Let me revisit my financial model. Okay, what if we expect this, instead of having 7% growth rate, let's have it at 9% or 10%. And you start rationalizing why you should actually boost your expectations and increase your forecast. And once you increase your forecast, what happens to your cash flows? They go higher. And what happens to your fair value? They go higher as well. So now, instead of having a 12 target price, 12 pound target price, now we can have a 20, or maybe 15, 16, okay? So now we still have upside. So the market went up, and so did my fair value. So you keep actually trying to follow up with what goes on in the market. And to avoid this, is basically have to forget about the market. And that's why some people just they don't even look at the stock market. You just look at the models and try to estimate the fair value. Then you look at the stock market and see what that stock is trading at. Because usually there's some impact for looking at the market. If it's positive or negative, it can actually affect your forecast. And your forecast should not be affected by the market. Because you're actually trying to estimate the market price. So you should not be swayed by the market performance. And then you have a tool since hypothesis with this studies. You have one called official market hypothesis. And they have different layers for that. We have the weak form, we have the semi-strong and the strong. And developed markets should have actually should be in this strong form. What's the strong form of the official market hypothesis? It's basically saying that all public information and private information reflect or are reflected in the market price. So basically, no one will make money because everyone knows everything. Everyone knows the inside information, they know the public information, so you cannot really make money out of that. This is the perfect environment. But even in the States, it's not the case because there's still some people know the inside information that others don't know about. So they can still make money using this information. So the US market, you could say it's less than, it's higher than semi-strong, but it is close to strong, but not really strong. In other emerging markets, like in Egypt, I think will be between the weak and the semi-strong. Okay? The weak form is actually saying that past history or past prices of the stocks, if you look at charts, and this actually refutes the use of technical analysis, says that you cannot really make money using technical analysis, because they say that the weak form says that if you look back here at history, and you see the history of all the stocks and the volumes and all the trading data, and everyone knows about this, this actually, you cannot really use this information to predict what's going to happen in the future, because everyone knows about it. And technical analysis, what they do, they look at history, look at the price trends, and to try to expect what's going to happen in the future using this. So actually, the weak form of the special marketing process, actually, it's against technical analysis, that technical analysis would not help. So what about fundamental analysis? Then comes the same strong form. It says that even if you know the history of the prices, even if you know some information, or public or non-market information, like the financial statements, the market or the competitive position of this company that you're investing in, the management team, even if you know this, you still cannot make money using fundamental analysis. So it's eventually, the three forms, they're devised by Fama, Professor Fama, and Eugene Fama, and we tried to, there's still some critics for this hypothesis, and that's why it's still a hypothesis. Basically, the market is not always perfect. From time to time, you'll find some mispricing for various reasons. One of the reasons could be that the company is not highly traded in the market, so not so many people know about them. So you find mispricing between the fair value and the market price. Some companies like, for example, Apple, you can find maybe 30 plus analysts covering the stock. Do you think that the 31st analyst who covers the stock would get something new or find something new about the company that those other 30 did not know about? The addition of the marginal utility of having some other analyst cover the stock would be very diminished, very low. So, but the value of fundamental analysis would be the highest if you look at companies that have never been covered before, or maybe one or two analysts only cover these stocks. Then you can have more insight into this company. So usually, well-covered companies, you're not gonna, no one is gonna find new stuff or other, but undercover companies, companies that are covered by few analysts or none at all, eventually you can actually find some hidden values. And when the Mubasher web report called Hidden Value, Hidden Gems Uncovered, so basically we look at fundamentally undervalued companies, and usually the undervalued companies are not highly traded in the market. They have very low trading volume. So this is where we want to be in, but you have to be patient enough for the stock to appreciate later on, as other market participants start understanding that this is value hidden in this business, and let's buy it, or maybe let's acquire it. Maybe it could be some strategic investor acquiring or making an acquisition on this stock. The other part is behavior finance, and this is trying to be aligning fundamental analysis with technical analysis, that psychology affects our decisions, and we have to be cognizant of these issues, so to avoid any being partial when you make a decision. You have to be impartial, you have to be objective as much as you can. Obviously, forecasting is not really objective because it's subjective to your own expectations, but at least you have some, you have laid down your expectations or assumptions, and you have to be able to defend them. Again, you have to play the lawyer role. So what are the things that we look at? I think we don't have a break, right? We just continue. No breaks, huh? Okay. We'll just have a couple of more slides. So what are the things that we look at in terms of fundamental analysis? We look at revenues, top-down approach, from look at the income statement, revenues, earnings, and growth. Growth is very important, because if you look at the revenues, they're just numbers, historical numbers. What you need to try to estimate is what's going to happen in the future, but this is growth. And not all growth, not all growth is equal. So for example, some company could be growing at 10%, and another company could be growing at 5%. But the company growing at 5% could actually be worth more, okay? Why is that? You have to put the picture together. You have to compare the profitability of each business. The company that's growing at 10% is actually makes less money on whatever investment retain. For example, you make a profit or return on invested capital of, let's say, 10%. And the company is growing at 10%. Another company makes only, not 10% return, makes 20% return. And they grow only at 5%. The company that's growing at 10%, they will make less money, or maybe not money at all, no money at all, because they only have return on invested capital of 10%. So whatever they keep in the company, whatever they retain, retaining profits, for example, instead of distributing profits, you retain all the profits. So why are you retaining them? To invest them back in the company, and buy machinery, buy new business, new production line, and so forth, and you retain this cash. If you retain this cash, you only make 10% of that. The other company makes 20% of it. So 10% on retail investment, even though if you're growing your cash flow at 10% as well, maybe it's not worth much, because the more you put in this company, the more it gets sucked. Because the investment that you're making, the 10%, is not large enough to compensate you for the risk that you're taking. So maybe the cost of capital for this company is higher than 10%, or maybe it's 10%. So if you make 10% and your cost of capital is 10%, you're actually not making additional value. So whatever growth that you have will be gone. Why? Because you're making still 10% and your capital requirements is to make 10%. So you're not adding any value. The company that's growing at 5% could be adding more value because it's making 20% return on its investment. And the cost of capital is 10%. So you're making additional 10% of profits. So the return on investment is high, investment capital is higher than the capital, the cost of capital. What I'm trying to say is that even if you have a high growth company, do not be fooled by this high level of growth, because it could actually be growing and destroying value at the same time. For example, companies management, usually if they find so much cash with them, instead of giving back the cash to investors, they say if I give back cash to investors will think that I have no other growth opportunities to invest in. So why don't I just invest in any new projects? just to retain this cash and grow my business. So now instead of me being a manager or CEO of a $10 billion company, I'll be CEO of a $15 or $20 billion company, because now I have more projects that I'm investing in. However, these projects could actually be negative in the present value, could actually be destroying value. So you retain more profits, you invest in the back in the business, you're growing, but you're growing in the wrong direction. That's why we have some terminology said guard growth at the right price. Growth at the right price. So you need to have growth at the right price. I don't care less about growth, high growth, if it's the wrong price. And the wrong price means that you have to make profits on the money that you return, that you retain, that's higher than your cost of capital. So if the capital is costing you 10%, the return that you need to make should be higher than 10% to make money. Otherwise, you'd be losing money and you can actually be destroying value. So growth is very important. And we talk about future growth, not historical growth. Because historical growth is all gone. It's already been priced in the market. You want to expect the future. And the return on investment, here's the return on equity. This is the return on your equity. What's the profitability of this company? And what's the profitability margins every year? Are they expanding? Are they declining? Are they declining for a short period of time for them to gain market share? They start growing again. For example, Amazon.com, they started in the business of selling books online. Then, now they've been losing or generating losses almost every year since they were established. And only recently they started churning out profits. But why have investors been actually invested in the stock, Amazon.com, back in the days? They made so much money in investing in the stock because the investors were looking at the future. You're not looking just in the near term. If you look at the near term, the company is losing money, it's not going to be worth much, and actually the stock should be lower. But actually, people were thinking about what's going to happen in the future and how the company is changing its business model. And the company keeps retaining or generating cash flow that keeps retaining them. And this cash flow is actually being used to expand the business further. So the plan is to have the highest market share of the online environment. And this is what happens. Amazon.com, actually the price went up so much because expectations have been materialized and the company has been growing quite a lot. And been making higher market share. So the financial statements that we look at, we have three main financial statements. The balance sheet, income statement, and cash flow statement. And the statement that's mostly ignored is the cash flow statement. It's the third one, it is actually the most important one. Everyone looks at the income statement, want to know what the revenues are, what the net income is. However, the income statements all accrue in the accrual system, meaning that it's not really cash. Some of it is cash, but it's not all cash. And the balance sheet is just a snapshot of what the company's balance is like at a certain point of time. But it's just a snapshot, it doesn't give you what's happening over a period of time. So the cash flow statement is the most important one. But it's also an important part of the financial statements that you need to at least take a look at, which is the financial auditor report. Because usually most of the time they have no comment, major comment on the financial results. But you need to read it, to go through it, make sure that there's no major issue with the financial statements. Because the financial auditor has done the job by investigating all the paperwork of the company, trying to make sure that all the revenues, or most of the revenues, because they can have to search or investigate all the revenues, but they take sample and they make sure that the revenues reflect really the performance of the company. So sometimes you find some issues in the financial audit report, so you need to be aware of that. But the most important financial statements, essentially it's balance sheet, income statement, and cash flow statement. Just go one by one for the balance sheet. Balance sheet usually is more important for banks or financial institutions because this you need to look at what the bank has in assets and liabilities because this is where the cash will be generated from. For example, if you look at a bank, this would not be a typical bank balance sheet. You would have loans on the asset side and you have deposits on the liability side. And loans is where you make money out of. And deposits is what what you pay, this is your expenses you pay, this expense on deposits. And the bank makes money by making the trade-off, by making more and paying out, making more on the loans and paying less on the deposits. And this is your margin, net interest margin. However, what we look at the banks, the balance sheets of banks, instead of looking at income statements to start with, we look at income statements, but for banks, we look at the balance sheet first. Because the balance sheet for the banks has a different nature. It's not really historical cost, it's mostly cash. If you look at loans are cash, deposits are cash. So if the customer wants you to withdraw the deposits, to get whatever they have in the balance sheet, nothing else. Loans, you can actually include the loans that you've lent out to investors. If you lend out $1,000, when the time comes, when the client pays back the loans, it will be $1,000. There's no default. So loans, deposits, most of the balance sheet for banks is actually cash. So it makes sense for you to look at the balance sheet and look at the equity part, which is assets minus liability. Because if the assets are mostly cash and liabilities are mostly cash, the equity is mostly cash. And when we evaluate the business, any business in the stock market, what we want to do is actually try to come up with a market value for this book value. For banks, the book value of the balance sheet is very close to the cash or the market value that we be looking at in the market. However, it's not exactly the same. Why? Because, again, the balance sheet is the snapshot as of today. And when I buy the stock, I'm not buying the stock just for what happened. I'm buying the stock for what is going to happen in the future. So there's a missing part. If I just take the market, or I consider the book value for bank as the market value, is this enough? What's missing? How this book value will expand in the future? How will it grow in the future? So the growth part is missing. Okay? So the growth part here, you add it using the valuation models, and then you come up with a fair value or a market value for the bank. So the bank can, a starting point would be the book value. Then you add the growth aspect. And for this, we use the model valuation called price to book valuation. So that if the bank is growing, you'll be willing to pay more than the book value for the stock. But how high or how, well, what's the additional value that you can pay? It depends on the valuation model that you use, and there's one that we can use. It has some factors against return on equity and growth. The higher the ROE, the higher you'll be paying for this stock. The higher the growth, the higher you'll be paying for this stock. So this is for banks, but for industrial companies and service companies, balance sheets are not that important in terms of generating cash flows, because most of the values on the balance sheets of industrial companies are historical costs. The company could have actually been in the business 100 years ago, so the balance sheet shows their fixed assets at very historical numbers, and they're not really reflecting the market value of the business. And I would only be looking at the balance sheet as a first step, for the first statement to look at when you look at the industrial company, only if the company is maybe bank going bankrupt or being acquired or being dissolved. Because I want to see what is the market value of all these assets that they have, and what's the market value of these liabilities that they have, and whatever the net result, assets minus liabilities, this would be the fair value of the equity. So it's almost like marking to market, marking all the assets and liabilities to the market prices. Actually, the net result would be the fair value of the company. But this is in the case of the company just being liquidated now. But the companies are not liquidated. There's an assumption that they're going to be for infinity. Okay? So we don't really need to look at just income balance sheet, to look at income statement as well. The income statement, looking at growth, companies can be growing their profits. But how can they grow their profits? There are two ways to grow your profits. Either you sell more with the same cost, okay, or the same profitability ratio, or you improve your profitability ratios. Okay, so if you make 20% net margin on $100 of sales, you make $20 profits. So how can you increase this $20 of profits? If you grow the 100, if you grow the 100 and you maintain the 20%, you will make more. So the 100 becomes 200. Now you're making $40 as opposed to $20. So you've grown your earnings. So to grow your earnings and grow the top line. So the top line is very important. Earnings. Okay. But sometimes the markets are not doing well, and in the sector that you're in is very competitive, you need to reduce your prices, you're selling less because of the economic conditions, so now you're actually making less profit, less revenues, less top line. But you can still make money if you cut your costs and instead of making 20% of margin, make 25% of margin, net margin. So now if the 100 is, that is down to 90, and you make now 25% of that, that's higher than $20. So you can grow your profits, the bottom line, by growing your revenues and or increasing your profitability margins. And after the financial crisis in the States, when companies, the company was not doing that well, but the companies or the corporate environment, you know, the corporate America, so to speak, corporate America has actually been doing quite well. And they've been accumulating cash and they've been growing their earnings. How are they doing this when the economy is not doing that well? Revenues are not growing much, but their costs are being reduced. So you're making more profits. Okay. So you need to analyze why the company is profitable. Is it profitable because it's growing and maintaining the cost structure? Or is it profitable because they're kind of creating synergies and cutting costs? And eventually, if you just focus more on cutting costs, this would be a very short-term, in the short-term in nature, because eventually, at some point in the future, you cannot reduce your costs just to much further. So you need to focus now on the growth of revenues. Growing revenues is much more important than cutting costs, because there's a limit to cutting costs. So here in the income statement, you have sales. This is your top line. And you have the cost of goods sold. And you can get out of that the gross profit or the gross margin. Then, if you subtract selling general administrative, you get the EBITDA, or earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. And this is as close as you can get to cash flow, EBITDA, okay? Because it's before depreciation and amortization. And depreciation is a non-cash item, because it's just depreciating an asset that you've paid for years ago, just depreciating it in terms of accounting. So it's not really a cash item. So EBITDA is close to cash flow, but it's not really cash flow because sales are not all cash. You can be selling products on credit, so you have some accounts receivable. So if you sell some product for $1,000, so maybe you've only collected $800. So there are $200 that are actually not being paid in cash. But eventually, you expect them to be paid in cash in the future, maybe in the next 3 months, maybe next year or so. So you need to make some adjustments to this income statement because it's not all cash. Even though EBITDA is close to cash, but it's not all cash. So if you go all the way down again, you subtract depreciation, amortization, and then EBIT, you subtract net expense if you have taken any loans, you have profits before taxes, you have net income. So net income here is the bottom line. This is what the line item that everyone focuses on. But it could be misleading. If you see that net income is increasing, it's not always a good story. It could be a bad story because you need to see the essence of this growth in net income. Is it coming from cash flows or is it coming because the company is trying to sell as much as they can on more lenient credit terms? So now instead of collecting their sales 2 months later on, now they've given 6 months grace period to clients. Clients could still pay back the money in six months. But you would extend from 2 months to 6 months, you have four months gap that your company has to finance. And the financing of this nature is very expensive for you. So this is actually locking up some cash in the business. So it's not always great to see just revenues grow and net income grow without having enough cash. And that's why you need to compare this, turn this into a cash statement to see exactly are you collecting enough money from these profits or not. Companies could be profitable, but they could be still losing money, even though they're profitable. I can easily turn a company that's losing into a profitable company. Simply, for example, by changing the depreciation methodology. Instead of depreciating over 5 years, I can change my methodology and depreciate the asset over 10 years. Now I've reduced my depreciation expense. Now I'm turning my company from lower profits to higher profits or from losses to profits. So this is just about accounting, it's accrual accounting. So accrual accounting is just trying to allocate revenues and costs to a certain time period. But this is just accounting. It's not really real cash flows. That's why we need to look at the cash flow statement. And the cash flow statement, there are a couple of ways of looking at them, but most of the financial statements, we have them separated into three blocks: operating cash flows, investing, and financing. And for me to value a business, I don't need all three blocks, I just need the first two blocks: operating cash flows and investing cash flows. And as you can see here, operating cash flows starts with net income. This is the bottom-up approach. And it takes net income from income statement, and then it goes back and tries to make some adjustments. Because at the end of the day, as mentioned, net income is not cash. It's not all cash. So you have to make adjustments. So net income is actually after depreciation. But depreciation is not cash. You have to add that depreciation. So now you're turning net income into more cash. Okay? But revenues. Revenues are not all cash. But if you're taking the revenue altogether, $1,000, you have to take out the $200 that went into accounts receivable, because it's not in cash. You haven't collected them yet. So that's why you start with the net income, then you start turning this into cash by adding back the depreciation, any non-cash item. Then you make the adjustment using working capital. And working capital here mainly takes into account the operating, the working capital is accounts receivable and inventory on the asset side, and accounts payable on the liability side. So for my example, $1,000 of sales that you've made, and you've only collected 800, and now you have 200 still not collected, that's higher accounts receivable. Higher accounts receivable is an asset, so the higher the asset, the negative cash flow that you have. So when you increase assets, it's a cash outflow. If you decrease assets, it's a cash inflow. On the other side, if you increase liabilities, even though it's a liability, it's a cash inflow. You've taken on more money. If you decrease liabilities, almost like you paid down debt, that's a cash outflow. So accounts receivable is actually increased by 200. So I've made 1,000 sales, but only collected 800, and 200 has increased in accounts receivable. The 200 now is a cash outflow. So if I take out that number out of the net income, after adding depreciation, now I'm adjusting for the revenues. So I'm actually saying, and then I didn't collect 1,000, I collected only 800. So because I subtracted 200 now from my bottom line. So this is what the change in working capital does. It reconciles the income statement into cash, from accrual into cash. So the operating activities here, or the cash flow operating activities, gives me the change or the positive or negative cash flows from operations for this company. And now I can compare this to net income, or just to align them together. So to understand if the net income growth in the income statement makes sense or not, you can plot historically on net income of the company, and you compare them to operating income or cash flow from operating activities. If they turn together, it means there's nothing fishy about it. If you see that net income is going and operating cash flow is going down, something is wrong. Not necessarily wrong in terms of legal, but could be just changing the accounting policy. Now, if you see that income is increasing, because they change the accounting policy to the depreciation, because the depreciation is not cash anyway, and that's why they now make higher profits. But operating cash flow itself is going down. Now there's an alarm for you to dig deeper why is operating cash flow is going down. So the important thing for me is operating cash flow, this is what the company is in, the business of generating cash flow from operations. If the company is generating cash flow from non-operation or non-operating items, selling, for example, land, they're not in the business of selling land, selling securities, making profits on them, and they're not in the business of doing that, this is the concern for me. This is not the main purpose of the company. They're not the main activities. So I need to make sure that they're making enough profits from their main activity before I go any further down. So this is the first block, cash flow from operating activities. I'm adjusting the net income to operating cash flows. The second block is investing activities. As I mentioned, for you to grow the business, you need to invest in the business. You cannot just grow by not giving back or at least maintaining the quality of your assets. The quality of your assets would deteriorate if you don't do some maintenance. If you have a factory and you're not doing any maintenance, eventually the factory will shut down because your spare parts have to maintain the quality of the asset itself. So you have to make some investments. Investments are paid in cash. So you pay cash to invest further in your fixed assets, and we call this CapEx, or capital expenditures. And this could be in the form of new product, new production line, or maybe just simply maintaining the quality of the existing production line. And here, the block here is for investing, for cash flow from investing activities. But I'm really concerned about the continuity of the business. So I'm thinking about the business as a business owner. I need to understand where the cash flow is coming from, the operating cash flow, and how much I'm putting back in the company to maintain this company in the future, which is CapEx. There are some other cash flows from investing, like if you sell an asset, it's a cash inflow. You've made an investment decision to sell an asset, you generated cash flow. Reduce the asset, cash inflow. If you've bought an asset, assets will increase, but here you have a negative cash flow from investing. Okay? But this is just sale of assets or purchase of assets. If it's not related to the fixed assets of the company, I'm not really being concerned about. What I'm being really concerned about when I value a business, operating cash flows minus any cash outflows for the fixed assets, CapEx. So it's operating income minus CapEx. Sale of assets could be just 1 year and it will not be repeated. So I'm looking for recurring cash flows. The last block is financing activities. This is where you see the change. If you look at the balance sheet is split into two sides. Left side, actually it's top and down. The top side is assets. These are assets that are owned by the company. But how are they being financed? They're being financed using liabilities like debt and equity, okay, from shareholders. So you have two groups of capital providers, lenders or creditors and owners, shareholders. So the change the financing cash flow from financing activities takes care of that. It basically tells you how you've been financing your balance sheet. What's the change in the balance sheet? So if you've taken on more debt, you have a positive inflow because you've taken on more debt. If you paid back debt, you have negative cash flow. You paid down debt. And you paid out dividends to your shareholders, that's cash outflow. You find here dividends as a negative number because you've paid out the dividends as cash flow. Sometimes you find dividends in investing activities, but it's not the company's dividends. It's the dividends received from subsidiaries of the business. So the company could actually be a holding company owning some subsidiaries that they pay. So it's the shareholder, in essence, it's the shareholder of a subsidiary. So when the subsidiary paid out dividends, that's a return on investment for this company. So you find the dividends showing up in investing activities. This is a different type of dividends. The dividends in the financial activities, the dividends of the company itself here in question, and this is always negative. It's paying out dividends. Either zero or negative. Capital increase, if you take on more equity from the market, increase your capital, you see here an increase in cash flow. If you add all three together, this gives you the change in cash. And the change in cash is basically trying to reconcile how the cash here changed from 1 year to another. So if it's 100 and became 120, want to know where the 20 came from, just go to the cash flow statement. You see the change in cash here would be 20, it's 100 plus 20, 120. But where did the 20 come from? You look at all these three blocks, you'll understand exactly where the money came from. So I'm not really, if you discount the cash flows, some people make a very silly mistake of just looking at the cash flow here, or the cash balance sheet, or the cash balance on the balance sheet, and you discount that. You expect it in the future and discount it. No, this is a snapshot, it's not an inflow. You need to look at the operating cash flow minus CapEx to get the free cash flow for the company. This is what you discount. So for some of the ratios, we can look at the profitability. I mentioned return on equity, which is net income divided by book value or equity, shareholders' equity. You can look at the profitability margins of the business and compare this to over the time. So you have two ways of comparing the financial performance. You can look at time series, the same company years back, and you see that improvement and the further deterioration of the profitability ratios. This is one thing. And you can have another view, which is cross-sectional. comparing the same company for this year versus another company in the same industry, that same year exactly, and you compare apples to apples. So you see, you can tell if the company is more profitable than the competitor, or more profitable than historically, you can have an idea of what's going on, or what went on in the past. You have different ratios, net margin, we mentioned net margin before, like how much money you make out of that sales, is it 20%, 10%, whatever it is it improving or not? Financial and liquidity ratios, you have debt to equity. The higher leverage that you, the company has, more debt versus equity, the more risky or the riskier the company is. So even though if you take on more debt, it's actually cash inflow to you, but it's actually eventually you have to pay back this debt, and on top of that you pay the interest expense. So there's a certain formula or a certain level of debt that you need to take, and once you exceed that level, your risk becomes higher, and now investors may think or may require a higher rate of return now that you become a more leveraged company. So also, you can sometimes you have a company that's taking on a huge amount of debt, like 2 billion now. Is this a high level or not that high? Compare this to another metric. You compare it to the operating cash flow of the company. You can already compare it to the EBITDA. EBITDA comes from the income statement. It's earnings before it's tax depreciation and amortization. So if it's 2 times, compare this again to similar companies. Is this the norm for the industry? Is it 2 times that you take on debt that's twice your EBITDA? What does this ratio tell me really? It tells me in a simple way that it would take you 2 years of debt to, over EBITDA is 2 times. It says here it would take you 2 years to pay down the debt using your operating cash flow. Some other company could be 5 times. It will take the company 5 years to pay down their debt. That's a highly leveraged company. But debt itself is not enough. Sometimes we look at, or we usually look at net debt. Because if you've taken on more debt, maybe some of this debt still stays in your bank account as cash. So still it's there to be paid down, to pay down your debt. So a better view is to look at net debt divided by EBITDA. So you take into account the cash that you have in the balance sheet. So if you've taken, your debt is 2 billion, but you have 1 billion of cash, so actually your net debt is 1 billion, okay? So you take the 1 billion and divide by the balance, see how many years it will take you to pay down that net debt. But valuation, as I mentioned in the beginning, it's all about discounting cash flows. And the simple way of looking at fair value of stocks is to discount future cash flows using the appropriate discount rate. If you use the equity cash flow, you have to discount using the cost of equity. If you use the cash flow to the firm, you have to discount using the weighted average cost of capital, including equity and debt. So here, I'm just simplifying the way of looking at the future value is present value. If you put money in the bank, $100, now it's 110 later on after 1 year. That's a 10% yield or interest. If you work it away backward, so the 110 in the future is worth actually 100 today, because if you have taken $100 today out of investing in the bank at 10%, then I would end up with 110. So what we do actually in finance is basically use this discounting formula. We expect the future cash flow, then we discount it at the appropriate discount rate to come up with the fair value today. So the one easy way to value a stock is to look at just the difference. So, for example, if a my company is paying, you have to also decide whether this is the right model to use for your company or not, because if the company is not paying any dividends, the value of the stock will be zero. But it's not, I mentioned Microsoft was not paying dividends and the stock was appreciating. But because the dividends here, dividends count model, is basically looking at the actual cash dividends being paid out. But companies do not usually pay out all their profits. They can retain most of their profits, if not all. So if you retain all your profits, the model here will give you zero value. So you need to look at another model, financial preparation model, which takes into account the potential dividends that the company could have distributed to the shareholders. Because at the end of the day, the dividend payment is not does not have to do with the financial performance. In essence, it has to do with the financial performance, because if you have, if you make more profits, you can have potential dividends that you can pay out. But it's a management decision, or it's a shareholder decision at the end in the general assembly. If you the company can make 100 million, but the management recommends no payments to be paid out in dividends. That's a decision. Another management could have said, no, we paid out 50% of that. So the dividend payments is subject to management suggestions and approval of the shareholders in the general assembly. So we have, you can have two identical companies, one that pays out dividends and one that does not pay out any dividends. So the one that doesn't pay out dividends use this model to be worth zero. If they use another model, it will be worth something. So the more payments you make as dividends, the higher the value of the stock will be. That's why we'd rather use another model, but I'm using this simple one, but the other model is actually what takes into account the potential dividends, and we call it free cash flow to equity. And you can think of it as free cash flow to equity is in two parts. The dividends that are being paid out really, the 20% payout ratio or 50% payout ratio, and the missing part, which is the cash flow that has been retained in the business that could have been paid out, but the management decided not to pay out the cash flow. So the free cash flow equity takes into account both sides, what's really being paid out and what's not being paid out. Dividend discount model looks only at what's being paid out, okay, one part of it. So we take this example, basically, for you to make return on a stock, you need to get cash, which is the dividends, and you need the stock to appreciate, so you can make money when you sell it. So you can break it up into dividend yield, dividends for next year, divided by the price of the stock today, plus growth. And growth here is growth in the dividends. How much are you going to grow in the future forever? So for example here, you have a 5% dividend yield, okay, and 15% growth rate. My required rate of return is 20%. Okay? 20% is my required rate of return. This is the required rate of return that I would use to discount my cash flows. As I mentioned, here, in discounting, the discount rate here is your required rate of return. How much money you want to make? In this example, I'm giving 10% example. So if you want to give me money in the future, I would ask for 10% return. Because this is the comparable opportunity or the opportunity cost of 10%. Here, my opportunity cost is 20%. So I'm going to be using this to discount any future cash flows to today's present value. So what I need to do, just expect the dividends for next year and divide by cost of equity minus growth of that dividend. And growth here, this is a special case of dividend discount model. We call it the Gordon growth model. And the Gordon growth model is used only when the dividends is expected, or dividend is expected to grow at a constant rate forever. So if the dividends here is expected to grow at 10% forever, I can use this model. What if the dividends are not expected to grow at a constant rate? I can expect the dividends for the next few years until it reaches a stability phase. Then, from which I would expect stability or stable growth or constant growth. Then I can use two models then. I can discount the first few years of dividends. Then I add the future or the present value of the future dividends that will grow at a constant rate. So I'll be using the Gordon growth model maybe three or four times, 4 years, not today. So I'm using it today because I'm expecting that dividends will grow forever at 10%. So what did I do? I took last year's dividends, 1.1. Then I grow it by 10% because it's the growth rate I know or I forecasted. So the 1.1 is now going to be, this is the dividends that have been paid out last year. And 1.1 was 10%, this is the 10% growth rate for next year. So I'll expect 1.21 for next year dividends. Then I discount this by cost of equity, 20%. This is my required rate of return as an equity investor. Minus 10% growth, which is growth of the dividends until infinity. So if I divide that, 1.21 divided by 10, now I'm valuing the stock at 12.1. This is the value of the stock today, according to my estimates. There are factors here that could change this valuation. That's why you have different valuations. The dividends here could be, this is not going to be changing, because you know 1.1 is already actual, but what will change here is the 10%. So it's all about growing at what rate, and what's the discount rate that you want to create to generate. So if you have a higher discount rate, what will happen to the value? If I increase the discount rate here, the denominator would increase as well, and the value of the stock will decrease. If you need more return from the same stock, you need to buy it at a less price or lower price. If the growth increases, so 10% here will increase, and 10% in the numerator will increase as well. The numerator will be higher, and the denominator, okay, will be lower, because it's a negative number here. So actually, the total will be higher. So the value of the stock will increase, the growth rate increases. Makes sense? If you grow more, you gain, you increase value, higher, value at a higher price. If you have a higher discount rate or a higher requirement to return, the value of the stock will be lower. So as of your, if you value a bond, and the higher the risk, the higher the return that you need. So if you want to get, there's high risk now, and now you require a higher return, for you to make this higher return, you need to buy the stock at a discount. So you're not going to be buying at 10, you're going to be buying at 9 or 8 to generate this 20 plus rate of return. This is just a simple equity valuation model with the discount model, but not really. It's not usually used in all the stocks because it should only be used for stocks that really pay high level amount of dividends, like pharmaceutical companies, utilities companies, mining companies, okay. So for other companies, instead of using the dividend discount model, because it will give me a very low value because they usually don't pay dividends that much, and you retain most of the dividends to reinvest in the business. Look at a different cash flow model. And the cash flow model here comes from the three statements that I showed you before. Income statement, cash flow statement, balance sheet. And here is the cash flow. I do this for every year. I get the net income for the year. Then I reconcile this by adding back any non-cash items, depreciation, amortization. Now I have gross cash flow. Then I need to subtract the investments that I make in the business. So I mentioned before CapEx, this is CapEx. So 112 is actually how much money I put back in, or added in fixed income, assets. So fixed assets has increased by 112. This is an investment for me. So it's a negative number here that I'll be subtracting from my operating cash flow. And operating working capital investment, 27, means that I'm adjusting actually the net income by 27. I'm taking down the net income by 27 because this is an increase in working capital. If working capital increases, this is an investment. If it decreases, it's a cash inflow. It's coming back to me. Working capital is current assets minus current liabilities. Okay. So if the net amount, which is working capital, increases, that means that you have more investments in working capital and you have to adjust for it. More accounts receivable, more inventory, as opposed to more accounts payable. So that's why I have higher working capital. So if you subtract it, now you adjust the net income totally. You adjust it for depreciation, you adjust it for the working capital changes, to account for the change in revenues and costs, and you've taken into account how much you need to reinvest in the business to continue the business. Because the assumption here is the business will continue forever. Then you subtract the 247 minus or the gross cash flow minus the gross investments. You come up with the gross cash flow, okay, which is 108, which is the free cash flow to the firm. This is the free cash flow available to the whole firm, meaning the capital providers, two capital providers, the lenders or the creditors and the owners of the company. So when I discount this, what discount rate should I use? This is the cash flow before I pay any interest. So what do you think, what's the discount that I should be using? Is it cost of equity? Cost of capital, what's the average cost of capital? Because now I'm using the cash flow numerator, I have to have the matching between the numerator and the denominator. My cash flow numerator is the cash flow to the firm. The denominator has to be the cost of capital because we're talking about the whole firm, not just equity. So I discount this by calculating the weighted average cost of capital. Just a, it's a weighted average between the cost of equity and the after-tax cost of debt. So if my cost of debt here is 12%, I pay taxes of 25%, the net cost for me is 9%. Why is it 9%? Because I have a tax sheet that reduces my taxable income. If I take on more debt, I pay more interest or more expense, I make less money, so I save on the taxes. So even though the debt is costing me 12%, my net cost is actually 9% because I saved 25% on taxes. So 9% cost of debt after tax, depending on the how I finance my assets, is it 30% debt, 70% equity, if this is the case, then take the weighted average, 9% times 30, plus 70% weight of equity times the cost of equity. Now when you calculate the cost of equity, it's 20%, so it's 20% times 70, plus 30% times 9%, I come up with a weighted average cost of capital of 16.7%. So this is the cost of capital that I'll be using to discount this cash flow. But this is just 1 year, so I do this for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years, whatever, how many years I need to do. And once I stop one certain year, let's say 5 years horizon, I have to calculate whatever happens after the 5 years. So I use the golden growth model. Again, this is when I say that cash flows will grow at a constant rate after year five. So I can use the same formula for the golden growth model here, but instead of having dividends on the numerator, I'll have free cash flow. The firm. Instead of having cost of equity here, we have the average cost of capital minus growth of what? Growth of free cash flow to the firm. So I can use this to get the continuing value or the terminal value after year five. I add them up together and I come up with the fair value of the business, of the assets themselves. But this is the value of the operating assets. And the value here, you have two groups that have claims against these assets. You have again the creditors, you have the equity holders. So you subtract that creditors, you end up with the equity. So operating value here is basically taking the discounted value of the free cash flow of the 5 years plus the terminal value. It's nothing with you, because you have the fair value, the terminal value also after you file. You come up with the operating value. Then you subtract the debt, you come up with the equity. And basically, this is one way of getting the value of the equity. Another way is to just use free cash flow to equity from the start. But instead of discounting using the weighted average cost of capital, you discount using the cost of equity. Okay. And this is the cash flow, what we call the potential dividends. Remember when we said dividends could be paid out or not paid out? So this includes both groups. Whatever cash flow I had, that could have been paid out to equity shareholders. But most of the analysts use this firm valuation model. We expect cash flows for the whole business, we discount using WACC. Then you subtract the debt, you come up with the equity. Once you come up with the equity, divide the number of shares, and you get the fair value of share. We have other valuation models, we call them market-based or comparable valuation models, like P ratios, price to book, price value multiples, price to earnings. It's basically taking the price of the stock, dividing it by the earnings per share of the stock. And you have also the price to book, and usually you use price to book model for banks. As I mentioned, book value banks are mostly cash, so you're trying to compare the price in the market to the book value of the bank. And you have the enterprise value models. Enterprise value is basically market cap plus debt minus cash. And market cap here is number of shares times the market price. Then you add the debt, then you subtract the cash. This is what you call the enterprise value. And in essence, this is the enterprise value of the market. This is what the market is attaching to the assets of the business. This is the market value. But what I did here, we actually have taken operating value here is actually the enterprise value that I calculated for the business. This is my fair value. But here, this is the market value, enterprise value, this is the market. We have market, yeah, plus debt minus cash. Enterprise value, you can think of it as if you're acquiring a company. If you want to acquire a company, you want to acquire all the number of shares. So you take all the market cap at today's price. 100% of the shares times the market price. This is your market cap. But this is not just your cost to acquire a company. Because once you acquire the company 100%, you owe whatever the company owes. Now the company comes to you. So you add back the debt, because this is a cost to you now. It's all owed to you. Minus the cash available on the balance sheet, because you can use this cash to pay down the debt. So this is your net cost to acquire the company. I've used this to relate it also to some other KPIs like EBITDA, DV divided by EBITDA, DV divided by ton for cement or steel companies, for example. My companies can take DV divided by subscribers, so you can get some metric out of it. Why do I do this? To compare it across different companies. So it's not just one company on its own, And I compared TV per ton for ice, TV per ton for iron steel, TV per subscriber for mobile, TV per subscriber for telecommunication, and so forth. And then we can have some comparable items. I would like to end with a couple of quotes from Benjamin Graham. He was talking about margin of safety, and basically he said that I'll buy the stock if it's undervalued, but I'll give myself 30 to 35% room of being wrong. So if you say, what does this actually mean? Let's say the stock is worth $100, this is my fair value, but the stock price in the market is 80, okay? So there's an upside potential, there's a 25% upside potential, but the stock is trading at 20% below the fair value. For him, this would not be a buying opportunity for him. Because why? Because he wants to get a margin of safety of 30% at least. So he would only buy the stock if the stock goes down to 70 or less. Fair value stays at 100, the stock price is at 80, I would still not buy it. Because I could be wrong, he wants to be very safe. So no, I'm only going to buy the stock if it's worth 30% or more less than the fair value. Otherwise, I will not buy the stock. Because I could, my assumptions could be wrong. So let me be a bit safe by using this margin of safety. He mentioned also something about Mr. Market, that the market, you can think of the market as a salesperson, comes knocking on your door every day, and he will be offering you shares and asking you to buy shares from you. And you always have the option of shutting the door and not answering to the salesperson, either selling to him or buying from him. And this resonates with Warren Buffett. He's also a student of these guys. And he said, I never attempt to make money on the stock market. I buy on the assumption that the put close the market for the next day and not reopen it for 5 years. So when he buys the stock, he's not really concerned about what goes on in the market. But for the competition, of course, he'll be concerned about what goes on. But this is looking for the long term. So if he buys the stock today and the stock exchange closes down, like happened now, what happened in Egypt in 2011, are you really concerned that you're not going to be able to sell the stock? Because the company is still there, the company is still generating cash flow. Even if the stock changes or change vanishes, you're still an owner of this business. If it's a good business, to make more cash, to give you back the cash. So you still have something that's worth something. Right? So that's why he cares about the stock market being up or down. He wants to buy into the upright business. This is also great investment opportunities come around when excellent companies are surrounded by unusual circumstances that cause the stock to be misappraised. And this is the mispricing Dr. Ali was mentioning also, the mispricing can be done then. But he said, it's great investment opportunities, it's not when you find cheap stocks. Because cheap stocks could be cheap for good. Because the company itself is not good, that's why the stock is cheap. So you need to find cheap stocks of excellent companies. So why would an excellent company have cheap stock? Because they have unusual circumstances. So this is when you buy the stock. If a business does well, the stock eventually falls, eventually. And then I refer back to Christian Bale, when he read the numbers, he understood what's going to happen in the future. But nothing happened all of a sudden, but eventually, whatever he thought, materialized. It's far better to buy a wonderful company at a fair price than a fair company at a wonderful price. So if you find a discount in the market, it's really a cheap discount, very, very little. Maybe it's a value trap. Maybe if once you buy in, the value goes even down further. You want to buy a wonderful company at a fair price, not a bad company or a fair company at a wonderful price. Last quotation is, the price is what you pay and value is what you get. So the price here, so always the two sides. What you're trying to do here, come up with a fair value. And this is what you're getting at the end. And the price is actually what you're going to be buying in the market. You're buying the stock at the price for you to get the value in the future. And this is what everyone is looking for. With this, I'll end. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Thank you for your time, thank you for coming.
secure our capital, discussing technical analysis, and last but not least, Mohammed is leaving next Saturday for the trading platform. Okay? Guys, please, before you leave, can we just take a minute to take attendance really quickly, just to save time, and for those who have to take the racing for the day, okay? Just sit down for 1 minute, I'll call out your names and then you can all come out.
Thank you.